Hi, welcome to Meanwhile at the Castle, episode 11. It's February 18th, and we're finally back after a month or so. So it's we're so happy to be back.
Settle in. Yeah. I'm glad if you're here. Thank you for coming back because we've been MIA. Missing in action.
Mm-hmm. So. And we've got lots to share with you today. But first of all, you can find me, I'm Emily, and you can find me on Ravelry as E.G. Clausen and on Instagram as Salt City Knits.
And I'm Deborah. You can find me on Ravelry as Purple Pinwheel on Etsy as Indigo Chicken and on Instagram as Indigo Chicken Dolls. And we also have a website,
which is meanwhileatthecastle.com. And of course, join the Ravelry group, which is the Meanwhile at the Castle Ravelry group. Yep. So we have some finished objects, some works in progress, some snippets from the past, an update on our sock swap, and a shop update information, which I think, I don't know that we're going to go exactly in that order, but that's what we've got. And just a heads up, for those of you who are participating in our sock swap, we will give you a warning, but you're going to have to leave for a while.
Yep.
So we can show
you. We'll let you know when and when to return.
All right.
So we have a whole bunch, and I have a huge pile here.
I have a smaller pile than you.
I'm gonna start.
Yes, here. Please do.
So, knitting goals for 2017. I had several. I wanted to knit 12 pairs of socks this year because I started knitting socks last year thanks to Emily's gift of hand-knit socks, my very first. And before that, I couldn't quite understand why it was such a big deal. And after that, I became obsessed. So this year, I wanted to knit 12 pairs of socks. So I began. I got a good start.
A good healthy start, huh?
So I began.
Now quickly, I have to clarify. Is your goal to knit 12 pair of socks total or knit 12 pair of socks for you?
Just 12 pairs of socks.
Okay.
I actually am planning that by the end of the year I will have 12 pairs of socks for me, but some of them I knit last year.
Sure. But, and then you're giving some away.
And I'm giving some away. So just 12 pairs of socks. And I wanted to try a variety of patterns and different construction methods. So anyways, I showed these last time. They weren't finished, but I finished them this year, and I knit almost all of it this year, so I feel like that's this year's.
Oh, yeah.
It was the Little Bobbins Knits Christmas Eve cast on. So I just did a vanilla sock. The yarn is by Up in Yarn Designs, who closed this week.
What?
Yep.
What?
She closed this week. She announced like 2 days ago that she was closing on March 10th or when all of her yarn sold, whichever came first. And within 24 hours, she was closed.
Oh no, I didn't. I missed. Lorelei.
I know.
Oh.
So I got one skein of her yarn. I kept thinking, I'll order this year. And I didn't. And I've missed my chance now.
Oh, that is. Well. So. I have to assume that it's for bigger and better things. So good luck to you, Lorelei, but we're going to miss you.
But I have my own socks from her yarn. So this one
beautiful.
Is Fart Flowers is the colorway. And I really liked this one. Just the colors were cheerful. Oh, we do have to move closer. Maybe I should move our camera, but that's okay. And the heel was Knit Picks Hawthorne in Park Rose.
Which is such a pretty color.
So just really simple. It's just a 2x2 rib, heel flap, which was a Eye of Partridge heel flap and gusset, and a wedge toe. Simple as can be.
Super cute. I love the sparkle in that.
So number one, done.
Yay.
Did it.
Wonderful. Kay. Go ahead and show another one because I'm in the middle
okay.
of a row.
Well, and I'm in the middle of a pile
more
here.
Stuff than I do.
I'm in the middle of a pile here. So the next one I started, I promised my youngest daughter, because everybody else had their own pair of socks that I had knit or that they had knit for themselves, but I promised her I would knit her a pair. So I'm started with, it's a big mess, so I'm rewinding it right now. This is Felici, Knit Picks Felici Bubble, which was the yarn that you knit for Aria, right? And did you end up getting?
Yes, I didn't even think, because we didn't go over that. I actually ended up with enough to make two pair of socks. I had two people send me. So I now have four balls of bubble sitting at my house.
Happy day.
And I haven't started on those yet, but Aria is very anxious. So
thank you, nice friends.
Yes, friends. Wonderful people.
Yep. So the heel, cuffs, and toes are in this yarn that I don't know what it is. It was a gift from Emily a year and a half ago.
I don't know if that might be Cascade Heritage. That is Cascade Heritage.
Oh, that's good to know, because I really, really, really like this one a lot.
That's Cascade Heritage, the one, whatever one it is that has a little bit of silk in it is what it
is.
Oh,
that's why I like it.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I started it, and I got the cuff done and two stripes of color, two rows of the stripes, wait, whatever that was that I meant to say. And then my daughter saw it, my 10-year-old, and she, how old is she?
Almost 10.
Okay.
She's got a couple months to go.
Either way, she's around that age. She saw it and said, Mom, show me how you use the DPNs. I was doing DPNs on this, and so I showed her how to do it, and then she confiscated the sock and took it from me and knit this. So.
That's fantastic.
I can't claim this one as mine. I did do the heel flap and gusset for her. So she's doing all of the stockinette stitching and I'm doing the other parts of it. But she did two rows and determined that knitting socks is her new favorite thing in the world.
That's so fun.
So with that, you need to show.
So I'll show the ones that Abby is working on. So my 9-year-old, I've visited with her, and you guys got to meet her in our last episode and saw her fun little interesting project.
She was so fun. I loved
she's
watching
so
that.
She's so spunky. She's so entertaining. But she, after we did that, she really got excited about doing more. And I think that was one of the great benefits of having our children. They felt really grown up and appreciated.
Yep.
So she decided she wanted to knit some socks too. So she's working on these. Oh, sorry. This is her little... her socks, and she's doing kind of little shorty socks. And this is also out of Felici in the, is this Time Traveler?
No,
this is
Time Traveler over here.
I don't know if I've got a ball, I didn't put the ball band in here. Whatever it is, it's one of those discontinued colorways. I don't remember what this color is, so I apologize. I will look that up and see if I can insert that. But she's doing these little shorty socks. Now I cast it on and I did the first two rounds of the rib and then she did the rib from there. And it's not a very long rib. And she decided she wanted little shorty socks, mostly because she was really excited to get moving on them, which I'm totally fine with. So then I did the heel turn for her. So she really hasn't done, you know, a great quantity of knitting on this, but some. And interestingly enough, she is liking the DPNs better too. I started her out on Magic Loop thinking it would be easier for her to manage. But it was very confusing to her to think back needle, front needle.
Mm-hmm.
As opposed to this, she can think, she can look and see where her yarn is. Oh, let me back up. When she was knitting on Magic Loop, she kept turning and then working back along the same needle she'd just been on.
Okay.
And so I'd have to go and do it. But now that she's working, and we've got some weird thing going on here. I don't know what it is. I'll fix it in a minute. But on the DPNs, she can look at it and find where her yarn is, and she can think right needle, left needle. And that's just worked in her brain better. Plus, I couldn't find any of my wooden needles that would work for Magic Loop, so she was working on some Addies, and they were too slippery. And this yarn is quite slippery and her stitches are a little loose. So she was having a hard time with the needle falling out. So I moved her to these are just Knitter's Pride. What are these called? Knitter's Pride Symphonies? Is that what they are?
I don't know. I haven't used their...
Yeah, they're wooden DPNs. And she loves this and she's been doing really well on it. And like I said, we've got some kind of little mistake there, but... So she's just plugging along, and it's so fun because she's, you know, if you look at that last episode to see where she's come from in such a short amount of time, that big old gappy, who knows what it is. We've decided, by the way, it's a shawlette for an 18-inch doll.
Oh, I think that's good.
With and lace. So we're going to put some lace. Buttons on. Yeah, the yarnovers is shaped like... Anyway, so be from that to actually knitting these little socks
that's
in
really
such
impressive.
A short amount of time. I'm really proud of her.
Yep.
And she likes it a lot. She's really having a good time. We've been watching podcasts together and just enjoying having some mother-daughter project time. It's been really nice.
I've been searching for
she
new
just
podcasts.
Picked up a stitch. That's all it was.
I've been searching for new podcasts and I've found a whole list that I've got to go start watching. Oh, I dropped the ball. That's the problem.
I did too a minute ago.
When you drop this and it rolls everywhere. We're going.
Okay, she's going to go. Just don't worry about mine. Mine's fine. Okay.
Well, it's because I'm trying to fix the mess my daughter pulled from the outside and the inside and wrapped them all together. And so I'm trying to fix
I know. That's one thing about having your kids knit is that in the middle of whatever you're working on, you have to pause to help them with what they're working on. But it's so fun.
I used to get really irritated by it, but then I realized one day that this is what I wanted. So I really need to make sure that I am always positive about it and never like, okay, let me stop again and help because, you know, I had to learn somewhere. Somebody had to help me and I want them to be, you know, feel good about it and always have positive thoughts and memories.
Yeah, so. Exactly. And I would not call myself a patient person necessarily. Anybody who knows me really well is like, necessarily? Yeah. But I have a lot of patience with teaching Abby to knit because she really does want to understand. She is interested in it. She really wants to learn. And it's something I love. Mm-hmm. And so it's very easy to think back not too long ago, not too many years ago, when I didn't know any of these things. And so I get to kind of share that learning process with her. It's fun.
All right. Alrighty. Next, here's another finished object.
Oh, yeah, socks. That's the time traveler.
Now, this is the time traveler colorway by Knit Picks Felici. And the heels, cuffs, and toes are just some yarn that I dyed from my first pair of socks. This mm-hmm. was what my oldest daughter, Claire, has been knitting, but she decided she really did not like knitting socks and just left it. And my middle child, Ella, said, well, I'll finish them. And she did some of it, and she did not want to finish it. So I want all of my needles. Everybody has these projects with all my needles on them.
Yeah.
I'm like, you need to finish the projects or I will.
Because I want my needles back.
I've gone through my whip basket. I'm going through that and everybody's bags of things that are just staying there endlessly and finishing everybody's projects. So
nice.
I only get a half. I only knit one sock.
You
out
get
of
half
this.
Credit.
Half credit. That doesn't really count on my 12 socks. I'm not putting that on there. Unless I do half a sock of another pair at the end and I need this half to complete it.
You know what? I say, if you are the one who bound it off. No, I'm just joking.
I also taught her how to do. Actually, they did really good. So
they did really
there's
well.
One. This is just a vanilla sock pattern again.
That's what you're going to see most of us.
I have decided, because I've been doing different patterns, that I really just like knitting vanilla socks.
So do I.
I just like
it's very therapeutic.
It is. So I do other ones to learn new skills and to just kind of do something different, but I found I don't enjoy it very much. So I just want to knit vanilla socks. So there's that half finished object that I might count at the end of the year if I need.
My guess is you're going to be so past your 12 by the end of the year that you won't.
I'm sure I will, but I wanted to be reasonable because I know towards the end of the year I'll start doing Christmas knitting.
Right, but you'll probably knit socks.
I probably will. But I want to be realistic and have an attainable goal that still is a challenge for
me. I agree with you.
So, you had several.
I'm going to show this one because I love this so much. Didn't you have something to show with this?
I do.
Okay.
I have so many piles.
Deborah's going to go wandering for a moment.
And I'll get your yarn.
Oh, thank you.
You
so happy.
Okay.
I need to put that in a bowl. All right. So this is the Loop Shawl by Casa Pinka. I'm going to try and get it closer so you can see kind of the fun little loopy texture. I just love this. And here is this cute, sorry to cover your face, see. Deborah.
It's okay.
You're good. So this cute little pico border that is so fun. And I'm so glad I did the pico border. I made this from Anzula Nebula for the base in the denim colorway. It's this gorgeous sparkle. I'm not sure if any sparkle is showing up on the screen, but this is all got this gorgeous sparkle through it and is a, it, I mean, it's definitely a grayer blue, but it's more of kind of a denim-y color. Mm-hmm. It's not just gray. It's definitely more denim. And then this cute variegated one is by WN Yarns, and it was the yarn I got from Nelia Pulaski's Yarn Elephant Exchange around Christmas time. And it didn't have a colorway listed, so I'm not sure what the colorway was, but it's just so fun in pinks and blues.
It looks perfect with that.
I know. I was actually a little worried when I first started going because the blue in the variegated yarn is almost identical in color to the denim. Mm-hmm. Color, but it, without the sparkle. But actually, it works very nicely. This was just the funnest project. I had so much fun knitting this. I thoroughly enjoyed it. I didn't super love the wrong side of the loop sections, especially at the beginning. Once I got rolling, I think I worked out the tension a little bit better on making my loops. But it's just the funnest little pattern.
Let's show the wrong side what you were talking about.
Okay, so the wrong side.
I'll hold one side. Okay.
If you can see it, it's, you still have the color carried across, but it's just kind of a funky little slip stitch stripe. So it doesn't have the loops on the wrong side. Mm-hmm. It's just stockinette in the background. And then it increases 6 stitches every right side row. Is that right? 1, 2. Is it 6 or 4? Now I can't remember off the top of my head. But every right side row. I found that when I blocked it, that my increase or my edges are fairly tight. And so it did curl up. You can see this quite a bit.
Oh.
Especially with this nice loose pico binding. But I love it because it hangs in this adorable curly Q, yeah. Which I think works perfectly with the fun little bobbly.
Mm-hmm.
I'm thrilled with the curly cues actually at the end. It's so cute.
Now, has Abby claimed it as her own?
Abby has worn it a few times, but I've worn it just as much. So here, I'm going to put it on so you can see it. It's just really fun. And I have a cute denim jacket I've worn it with. I've worn it with a pink sweater, a hot pink sweater that I wear a lot. And anyway, it's so fun. So I thoroughly enjoyed this. I think I will make it again as a gift. I can think of so many fun color combinations.
You made it really fast too.
I did. I went through it quite quickly because it was just really enjoyable. And I've been doing so much sock knitting that working at a looser gauge, even though it's still fingering weight yarn, you know, you're working with a larger gauge needle. And having some interest, I felt like it flew right off my needles and I just had a great time working on it.
I so like the colors that you chose too.
They're so fun.
It's very pretty.
It's so cute. But I will die of heat with multiple things on right now. That's where our room is warm.
Oh, hey, I didn't show what I was wearing today.
I know, it's so lovely. It really is.
I haven't actually worn it yet. I mean, I made it last fall.
Haven't I seen? I think I've seen you.
Well, I haven't worn it on our podcast.
Oh,
that's all,
yes,
I mean.
That makes sense.
Yeah, I knit this. This is really the first thing I picked up other than some doll sweaters and making a bunny. I decided to jump right
into
knitting lace with your help.
Yeah.
And this is
lace and cables.
I remember cables. Cables are far more simple. They look very impressive. So if you are a beginner knitter and you want to do something that's a little bit more than just stockinette, cables are the way to go because it's a big, you know, bang for...
I think the biggest thing is learning to read charts. If you've never read charts before, then that can be a little bit intimidating. At least it was for me the first time. Yeah. But
this wasn't charted.
Oh, it wasn't.
Which it would have probably been quite helpful.
Yeah.
I don't know. And up to till just recently, I haven't knit anything from a chart.
Oh,
and
I
so
love charts.
All the cables that I had done were I mean, it wasn't that I was looking for that. That's just uh-huh. how it was, what I found. But this is from book Knits from an English Rose. It's a capelet. I forgot what it was called, but I'll just put it down below.
Well, and it's honestly, it's in all of our some of our previous podcasts as well. So
and
you can find
so
all those.
So this was knit from yarn that my husband gave me as a gift that he found for me. It's alpaca. And I loved knitting with alpaca and decided that this was the wrong fiber for this because it's too drapey.
It looks quite
clingy,
pretty.
But I yeah, like it. I still love it. Yeah. So anyways.
Very lovely.
I actually am not going to talk yet about what goes along with your shawl, Emily, because I had one more finished object.
Oh, okay.
Because that other one is a work in progress. So one of my other knitting goals for this year was to learn to do color work. And so I was going skiing in January and I thought, well, I need a hat,
and you're a knitter, so you have to make it.
So exactly. So I decided I'm going to do some color work, and I knit the Split Back Snowflake Hat by Susan B. Anderson,
which is so cute. Ta-da! It is so
cables once again.
Cute.
This was so fun to do.
I really think I have to make this
I
hat.
I love this one. Okay. I think I did pretty darn good.
Yeah. Yes.
I mean, there's definitely some little tension issues here or there, but I did the two-handed mm-hmm. color work where you have one color in one hand, one color in the other hand, and you just alter, you know, depending on which color you need, you pick from that hand. But this, I did not enjoy doing the color work for the first two-thirds of the pattern. And the last third, I decided that it's not too bad. But the cables were my favorite. The hat,
that cable-y rib is
the
just
hat
so cute.
Is really cute. I liked this one because it comes down instead of wearing it on your head like this, which it also has an option. Mm-hmm. The pattern also has an option for that. It's worn more like this. I'm not like, putting it on. I'm just going to tell you that. You want to wear it?
Sure. Okay. It won't look good on me. I do not look good in hats.
I don't. Well, that's the thing. I don't look good in hats either.
Okay, if I can put it on. I'm not that smart.
I am so smart. S-M-R-T. Okay. Hey, yeah. You look lovely, Emily. Lovely.
It's cute.
Hair turned sideways. Let's see. Adorable.
So cute.
That looks way better on you than me. Maybe you should knit it in colors that matched you.
I really should. It's really, really, really cute.
So the yarn was...
It's really, really, really cute.
And it wasn't as hard. And this was my first time reading a chart and doing color work. And it was... No, well, color work chart scary. Is very simple compared to, I feel like, the pattern charts. Mm. Like, you know, what type of stitch are you using? Does that make any sense?
Well, it made sense to me, but that's because I can read your mind.
Yeah, she always finishes my sentence. So this was Cascade 220 Superwash in purple and gray. They're just numbers. 882 for the purple, and I don't know the gray because I'm not pulling out that band because then it will be a mess.
What? Is that just a cast on or is that?
It was just a cast on. One okay. row. One just row. Cast on with one color and uh-huh. then move right into the other
the next color.
So
cute.
I want to figure out something else to do. I think... I don't know. I just love this pattern here.
Oh, I know. So
just this for the bottom and then just plain have it just be a hat this direction.
It's
wow.
really that's good. It's a thing.
It is a thing. Okay. So I liked that one a
so
lot.
So fun. And you survived skiing.
Barely. I did not enjoy skiing. I'm just gonna tell you, those of you that love skiing, good job. Way to go. I survived. I can say I've done it. We live in Utah.
Greatest snow on earth.
And I don't like to ski. Okay.
Yeah, I've never been skiing because that would basically be a suicide mission. Okay, let's see. What do I have next?
So now, work in progress. Let's see. Do we have...
I still have another finished object.
Oh, you do? Yeah. Okay, good. I forgot about that.
So I also finished my Christmas Eve cast-on socks. And I feel bad. These, I have worn them and... Just like yesterday, I was wearing them. So they're a little bit stretched out because they always are that way. But this is Baron Vulla in the, hold on, it's coming to me, something orchid. Wild Orchid colorway. And this yarn was a gift from Erin, Mama to Abigail, who's from Holland Handmade. And I cast these on Christmas Eve and kind of worked on them. I actually finished them quite a while, and they have become my very favorite pair of socks. So I want to tell you what I have figured out. The perfect fitting socks, like coziest socks for me. 30 row cuff, and this is a 1x1, which I actually have been preferring for my own socks. 30 row cuff, 30 row leg. So just really short here. It just fits so nice and snug. And this yarn is so thick, like thick as in full.
Robust.
Like it really, yeah, I don't know how to describe
because,
what I'm trying to
say.
You know
what, Felici
yarn. It's substantial yarn, to itself.
I like Felici, but it is a finer
yarn. It's a finer yarn. Fingering, and it's very polished.
Yes.
Anyway, I love this yarn. These socks fit so nicely. They're so comfortable, and I just wear them. So I've probably worn them 6 or 7 times.
Do you do 64 stitches? Or
this is 68 stitches for me. And then I just did a regular slip stitch heel, turn and gusset, and a rounded wedge toe, which is kind of hanging out the end of Deborah's smaller foot planned foot blocker that I'm borrowing.
That's for my kids though.
Oh, no wonder. Okay, then I don't look quite so mammoth.
Because I'm using the ones for my feet.
Anyway, so I finished those and they were just really fun and delightful. And they're not really a Christmas colorway, but they totally work for me. Because I don't really do a ton of traditional red and green type Christmas
plum pudding.
There you go, plum pudding. We'll call it that. Those are really fun.
It's now a Christmas colorway.
There you go. Okay. I figure if you cast it on Christmas Eve, it automatically becomes a Christmas colorway.
I don't care. I would wear whatever color socks all the time.
I have two other finished objects, but I'm going to include them in segments a little bit later.
That's how I am too.
Okay, great.
Okay, so we're going to move on to works in progress.
Yes.
So one of mine goes along with Emily's loop shawl. I loved that one. I showed you on last episode some yarn that I got, and I wanted to make a shawl with it. I didn't know exactly which one, and I decided I needed to make Emily the shawl that Emily did. And I really loved that one, and I started knitting and went, something's not right.
This is so funny. I love this
one.
And
I called Emily, like, what in the heck am I doing wrong? Because I got to the end of the loop row, of the contrast color row, and there was no carrying it back. I was going to have to cut the yarn, weave the ends in, and I'm like, I'm not going to do that with every one of those rows. And so I knew Emily wasn't doing that because she kept talking about the return row, that was different. Mm-hmm. So the backside. So she told me, I am not knitting that same shawl. We haven't finally figured out. I'm knitting the dot shawl.
By Casapinka.
And she knitted the loop shawl. But they are so similar that I even labeled her shawl on the last episode the dot shawl. So
oh, really?
I didn't realize. That's wrong. Sorry. It's because I was confusing the two. So the dot shawl, it's just a variation on the loop shawl. She was just finding new ways to use variegated yarn. And so the contrasting dots on here are variegated, that's the right color.
The right word. Variegated yarns are the dots.
Yes.
In her pattern. Okay.
Well, I was changing it on mine. So mine, I'm doing the dots with a more solid, a tonal color. And then the variegated is the rest of the shawl. And so I decided to keep knitting that one because I really liked it. So this one, I'm calling my garden shawl because the yarn of the main body, it doesn't show as nice in here, but the greens and purples and pinks, it just makes me think of just a garden, all the flowers. The dots are just kind of these little baubles, but you have to cut the yarn at the end of each row and weave it in, and I'm doing that as I go. This one is really, really easy, but I really dislike knitting the dot row. I've decided
that's hard.
I really like it though, so I'm going to finish it. But this row, I did it this morning. I said I just have to break down and do it. It takes me an hour now to do 100 dots. Actually, it took me 45 minutes. It's because I'm usually busy eating chocolate and talking to everybody that it takes me an hour. So when I get to the row with 190 some dots. Oh. Better put in a couple movies and settle in. So, but the rest of it goes so fast that yeah. I do that, and then I have to wait till I have a chunk of time to do the dot row.
That's fine.
But the yarn I'm using is, this is the yarn for the dots. It is Malabrigo. I'm not going to say it because I can't say that.
I can't read it backwards. I can't read that either.
That's why I showed you.
Rupestra?
I don't know.
It's silk and merino, and the body, the main yarn that I'm using, is Mrs. Crosby Loves to Play.
Oh, that's what that one is.
Yes. Okay. Satchel.
It looks very different in the cake.
It does. I'll show you. Satchel is the base, and the color is Bahama Woodstar. This is what it looks like. Okay.
You gonna bring over the keg of yarn here?
This is what it looks like. Before it's caked up. I have a little bit of it. So, here, it's so pretty.
It is really lovely.
I love this one, which is why I have a lot.
Do you know what it reminds me of? And I mean this in the most complimentary way. Like, I really am complimentary. Okay. It reminds me of, like, old lady colors. But, like, I really like that.
In a nice way.
Yeah, like, kind of classic and old-fashioned colors. Like, a lady whose name is Iris, who wears lacy shawls.
Yep.
And has her readers around a beaded necklace.
That, like, sounds good.
Like, does that make
sense?
Maybe solves mysteries.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
She's a writer, by the way, and she's coming up with a story right now.
Yes,
she's a short story about this lady, and you need to name her
Bahama Woodstar.
Or Satchel.
Well, Iris Satchel.
She has
that works.
Iris Satchel.
It's like
actually, it could be Mrs. Crosby.
Bouquet.
Have you ever watched? Oh, what was the name of that one?
Keeping Up Appearances.
Keeping Up Appearances.
Okay. I'm sorry. I'm getting a little bit
giddy. I've said that a lot lately. I said it's bouquet instead of bucket. Yes. So it's funny, isn't it? I see a forest with moss and the flowers in there. I just see it as this really rich, like a richness. Anyways,
very nice.
I have a lot of this yarn for a reason, which I'll show later on in another episode.
All right.
So I have enough to knit everybody
everything.
All the things. So, okay.
Okay, well, I'm going to talk about this because I've been sitting here working on it. I'm working on my Cozy Memories blanket, and I haven't done a ton on this. I've actually had this cast on for a year, a little bit more. I cast it on Christmas of 2000, what year are we in? 15. So just over a year. And I got up to 100 squares, and then I kind of left it for a while because it was a nice square 10 by 10 piece. There it is, as much as you can see it. All right. And, but then I haven't worked on it recently, mostly because I was just working on a lot of Christmas knitting, and then my life has been insanity for the last 2 months. So I wanted to finish off a couple things, and then I thought, I'm just gonna go crazy on this for a while because I am so excited to work on it. And I realized part of what was holding me back, I was not enjoying the needles I was using.
What were you using?
I've been using carbons, and I have finally determined I don't like carbons. I don't like them. And I know a lot of people who really do, but they just don't work for me. There's the drag on the carbon's edge, but mostly I'm finding I don't care for Knitter's Pride needles, except for I like some, a lot of their DPNs are fine, but anything that's got the joins. And carbons, they have the carbon body, but then they've got the metal end for where it connects to the cable, and they've got the metal tip. And in all of those places, they just feel slightly rough, just ever so slightly. But I've actually even had to return carbon's needles because the joins were so bad. They were like gouging my yarn and I couldn't even use them. So I finally thought, why am I suffering through this? Just because I have needles I can knit this on doesn't mean I have to use those needles. So I pulled out a set of Chow Goos in a big, long, huge cable, which is not, I just have those for other projects, so you can magic loop things. So much more enjoyable. I mean, it's just so much more enjoyable. And these even have the bent edges right here, which I don't like.
I have not seen those. What type of
chagu lace?
I have some chagu lace,
but there's lace project. Ones that come with the bent and lace that don't.
Okay,
and so it's
that.
Just one of their options. And I don't really care for the bent ones. I mean, I thought it would really annoy me, but it hasn't because it's such a short little amount of stitches on there that I never really have to deal with it. They're just kind of in my hands and out of my way. Anyway, so here I am starting a brand new row on my cozy memories blanket. And the way I'm working it is I'm working it from the center out. So when I start a new row, I start it in the center. The block that's just left of center. So I cast on and then pick up those stitches and then work from that way, work over that side, over this side. So this is the front side and here is the center right here. So I cast on these stitches here, then I pick them up. And then from there, I'll just pick up all these stitches and pick up these. But I like to move them out this way. So I don't even know if you can tell.
Because of the center.
But this is my center right here. And everything radiates out this direction. And then they keep, those seams keep radiating out. So you get,
you can kind of see it
a little bit.
Yeah, I can see it
like
right here.
Like here in this gray, they're kind of radiating out. Like this, in creating these V's down the center panes.
And it does that this direct, you know, all the way.
I totally copied Danny Little Bobbins.
It's because it's smart.
That was where, and I just really liked that, how she had that. I think this looks really nice. So, and it looks nice when you've got the little stripy ones where you can actually see it show up in the color, like this one right here. Because your stripes are always going to be wider on the bottom and smaller at the top. Anyway, so that's so fun, and I'm just really excited to go nuts on that now. And I'm going to be helped in that because I just found out yesterday that I won a giveaway with, so again, Erin from Holland Handmade, Erin Quartering, she decided she's done with the sock minis because she's done a ton of blankets and she's ready.
She said
she's getting ready to get off this train. So she was giving away all of her leftovers and that was a significant amount. I mean, it was a bag of minis and she was doing a giveaway and I won.
I know. I'm so excited to see that.
I know. So I will have plenty of fodder to just.
Along with that.
Yes.
I decided I wanted to start my own.
Yes.
And mine. We were talking about this earlier. Yours is a cozy memory blanket.
Yeah.
And I want mine to be a friendship blanket because I want to do some swaps for some minis. Mm-hmm. And so I want to start my own. I think that we should splurge some time and get some signature needles.
I'm a little worried because they have the same joints. Like, don't they have the metal tips and then they am I thinking of the same needles?
I'm going to try it. And
you definitely do, and then I will
because
benefit from your
wisdom. Sounds like if you really want to enjoy the project, and this is what I've learned from you, Emily.
Yes, get good tools.
Good tools make all the difference because I spent, years that I was growing up learning to knit on really cheap tools. And I was very frustrated all the time, and I couldn't. And I borrowed some of yours once. This makes all the difference.
And they weren't even really good ones. I think you borrowed like just some of my less nice, but still real.
The other ones were also real because I could hold them my hand, but they were not enjoyable.
Well, it's just the difference between going to the craft store and buying some tools, which yes, you can absolutely use, but they're going to be harder on your hands, so you're going to get more fatigue. Your yarn's not going to slide, so it's just not going to feel enjoyable.
Yep.
Yeah.
So if you want to really knit and be serious about
if you really want to enjoy it and have pleasure
and just start with one. This is what I did. I went and bought one set of needles for the one project, and then that was it.
Yeah, exactly.
Then. For the next one, I bought the next. And so I don't have the full range and, all these different sets, but.
It's amazing how quickly, though.
Yes, that's what my husband said yesterday, and he came and saw my pile of needles. Wow, that's a lot of needles.
I find out, we'll talk about that later. Yeah. Okay.
So, other project, right? It's way over here. Another work in progress?
Yes.
Do you have other
work? I have one, one more. Yep.
Okay, in this bag, I didn't show my other bag because on here, this is a bag that I made. This is what my shawl was in. But look what's on there.
Oh.
Emily made it for me for my birthday.
It's a little blue, mini bluebird of happiness.
It's so cute.
Susan B. Anderson's pattern.
Very cute. So I made another bag using an old sweater.
How adorable is that? I love that.
It's this bright orange.
And it has that cute fabric in it that you made me that one purse out of. I love that.
So I just cut up a sweater to make myself a bag.
So cute.
And this is a bee that Emily gave me for my birthday. I like that one. So in here, I have a couple of projects, but we'll talk about one right now. It doesn't look like much yet. Queen Amber, you have to turn it off now for a minute if you're watching this before
Don't
you get
look.
It. Okay, here we go. You won't even know what this is anyways yet. But I am knitting some baby gifts. So Aww. I am knitting the Ophelia Bonnet by RDP Knits. Now, she has some really, really cute pictures on her Instagram and her Ravelry page, but she has a lot of different examples of it. And this is really newborn, I mean, brand new baby size. And I wanted to knit some like photo props.
Oh, fun.
And so this is a, where's my alpaca and silk? I can't find the, oh. Glimmer. It's just alpaca is the yarn that I'm using, but I wanted one that had a really good halo to it because I wanted it to be really soft. And so this will go really, really fast. So I'm going to knit this and a little like bloomers, little diaper cover.
Oh, cute.
For baby props for photos.
And just because they're pretty and cute.
I have some other things planned, but that's what I'm working on right now. And the needles that I'm using on this one, I am using the Addy Turbo Rockets for this one. And I like Addies a lot. So that's one of the needles that I like. So there's one of the projects in there. All right, what else did you have, Emily?
Hold on, I have to adjust here just a minute. I've lost my seat cushion. Okay. So, as has not been a surprise to anybody following me anywhere on Instagram or anything, I've been spending a lot of time at the hospital because of my sweet father-in-law who has been recovering from an illness. And somehow I ended up on Monday, just this last Monday, I ended up, So anyway, I ended up on Monday going with my father-in-law to have a procedure done, and he was going to be there all day. So I knew I was going to spend the whole day at the hospital, but I managed to get out the door with only a crochet project, which I'll show later, that was getting to the point where it was quite large and not easy to grab. Well, I had a short amount of time, and close by to where I was is this wonderful store, Blazing Needles, which is in downtown Salt Lake. And so I stopped in there for a few minutes and picked up, you know, because you gotta have another project. Plus, I just really needed a pick-me-up. Anyway, I picked up some yarn, and this is Malabrigo sock, and I don't think I put,
it's
the ball
right
band.
Here.
Okay, good. Malabrigo sock in
you can say
Impressionist
that one.
Sky, and it's just this really deep, rich tonal blue, and I love their sock. I mean, it is... It's 100% superwash merino, so it doesn't have any nylon in it, but it is superwash, so that's good. It's not quite as durable, but it's so butter soft, and the colors are just so deep. I don't know, because this is really not a me color, but I wanted a tonal because I'm going to do the monkey socks again with this one, and I've done the first row of the pattern, but you can't really see it. I mean, it's just a big blue blob right now. I did a 24 stitch 1x1 cuff on it, and I'm knitting these on Addy Turbo sock rockets. Is that what they are? Mm-hmm. Addy sock rockets. And Anyway, but I just have to say, if you ever come to Salt Lake, go to Blazing Needles. I took about a 30-minute break.
Here, I'm going to show there.
Maybe even a slightly longer. And it was about 30 minutes.
Here, I'm going to show that one.
Yeah.
So we can see.
I took about a 30-minute break and went over there, and I bought this. They wound it up for me, and then I sat down at the table in front of their fireplace, and there was really nice music playing and friendly people, and I sat and just had kind of a minute to be calm and happy, and I just, it's such a nice place. And they just announced that they are carrying a new line of yarn, and all of a sudden my mind is completely blanked, so give me just a minute and I will look it up.
Okay.
But they are one of the few people in the U.S. I'm so sorry that I don't have this right in front of me. What's the matter with me? Okay, hold on. Well, when I was there, they were actually
announcing it right then.
They were setting something up that was a big secret, and I couldn't see it, and so I kept. I wanted to hang around and just see what I was missing.
Oh.
And the one lady was like, I think they're almost ready to open things up and take it out. And so I thought, well, I'll just hang out for a little bit longer. But I really had to go. Oh my gosh, my brain has completely blanked. It'll come back to me in just a minute.
I think it would be fun if we did a little tour of all the local yarn shops.
Oh my gosh, here it is. Woolmies or Woolmies, however you say that. It's all German. I can't speak
it. Okay, spell it. Here we go.
Woolmeise. Everybody knows this yarn. It's hugely popular. It's gorgeous German yarn with beautiful colors, and it's really hard to get here in the U.S. Oh. And so they are now carrying it, and they're the only person in our state who's carrying it, and there's really not even that many in the U.S. who are carrying Woolmeise yarns.
That would be nice.
Or Woolmeise.
They do carry a lot of really nice
quality
yarns.
They actually told me they're working on trying to get hedgehog fibers into that store. So that would be really nice too. Anyway, so I'm just working on these little ones. And actually I've decided to keep these in my car. They're not even going into my house. They're just staying in my car so that I never get stuck in that position again.
Okay, with that, I think I'm going to show Notions pouch swap because it goes along with that. Okay.
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 Excellent.
Mama to Abigail on Instagram, Holland Handmade podcast, Erin Quartering. She has a yearly Notions pouch swap. And so I did a swap with... just a minute. Chris at Chestnut Fibers on Instagram and Etsy. And she sent me quite the package. It was lovely. So first of all, the Notions pouch that she sent me was this one.
That's so cute.
I have to say.
It's Mardi Gras. I never would have thought of.
Well, because I said I really like very bold, vibrant colors. Yeah. And so this is definitely bold and vibrant colors.
Yes.
And I definitely wear black all the time, and so black and bold and
vibrant.
And
you look so good in it.
But this is a really quality bag. Like, it's made very nice. I really like this bag.
Some substance to it.
Yeah, and it's the size is just perfect to stand right there. But when I first opened it, I thought this is a really large Notions pouch, and then I got opening things up. This was the Notions pouch that she sent me.
Oh, what a sweetie.
And this was a little sock project bag that she sent. And she sent me a whole bunch of Notions. Here are some little stitch markers that she had made, which I like. I put a whole bunch of Notions in here. And she sent me...
a DPN Cozy.
Yeah, DPN Cozy, which I use with my Magic Loop as well. And there were a whole bunch of same things that she sent me, but what I wanted to show was that I do not want to ever be left without knitting. This is my emergency knitting.
Okay, good.
It's going in my glove box. I am putting one in all the car glove boxes.
I usually have one in my purse anyway, but
you know what? There has been enough times that I've been left somewhere thinking, you know, I forget it, or I think, oh, I'm not going to have time to knit or whatever. And then I'm like, oh, I really wish I had that. And after watching Amber on the Yarn Hoarder podcast, she talked about how she got stuck at Walmart for 3 hours without her knitting. And she's like, what am I going to do? And I thought, I can never have that happen. I've got my emergency knitting. So look how adorable. I love this bag. I really thought, I don't know how I'm going to fit something in here. This is the perfect, perfect size.
Really,
I need a bit more. So this is 150 gram skein of Felici that I wound into two cakes, and then I wound some for cuffs, heels, and toes. They won't be really large socks, but that fits perfectly with my Notions pouch and the knitting needles for it. And so now I need one of these for everywhere. I'm going to have one. I need to make a whole bunch of these bags or order more. I wish that she wasn't in Canada because the shipping on that. Maybe if I'm going to order more, I'll have to order quite a few because I really like these bags.
That's a good idea.
So, emergency knitting, Emily, you need...
You can't just be stuck there. I mean, really.
I mean, how did people survive before without their knitting? Actually, they didn't. They had their knitting everywhere. We live in a digital age, and we're trying to take it back a little bit.
Yes.
So, she sent me a whole bunch of fun things.
And oh, my goodness. How fun.
Okay. I'm pulling some of the things out. I've actually used quite a few things already in there, so... They're not all in here, but she sent me some teas, herbal teas, and some wool wash. And I like this one, Cuticle Rescue.
Smart.
Love this. This
should
go
in the winter.
I want this in every Notions pouch. I love this. I've used that a lot. Some just little charms that you can color. Some fabric, a fat quarter. I like those.
Well, that's something.
Some little minis, which I started winding some minis and... notepad and a pen. But then she sent another bag and a DPN cozy that's the next size larger to use as a giveaway on our podcast. So we will hold on to this until we decide what we want to do for our giveaway. But it's a really nice quality bag. So that was really fun. Emergency knitting. Everybody get your emergency knitting
This bags is part of
together.
Your emergency prep. Zombie apocalypse.
It's coming. Be ready. Okay. Now I can use all these things.
I know. It's
I'm
exciting.
So happy.
All right. So are we to the time where we can talk about our sock swap?
Oh, this is so
fun. Okay. So if you are participating in our sock swap, as in if you are swapping with Deborah or I.
So Crystal, Nancy.
Aubrey. Look away.
Then we'll just fast forward.
Just don't look.
I'll put at the bottom what time to come back.
Okay, sounds good.
Okay, Emily.
All right. So I am making these for Aubrey, and she is Aubie McDobby on Instagram, or Aubs McDobbs on Ravelry. And I had so much. I am having so much fun just chatting with her and getting to know her a little bit better. But she is a woman after my own heart. She likes color. Although, the way she describes it, she says, basically, if a five-year-old would wear it, then that's what she would like. So, if you look at her Instagram feed, it's full of bright rainbow shade, variegated and fun, crazy colors. So, I wanted to just do crazy color for her. Because of that, I kept the pattern really simple, and I went with this.
Very
Sorry,
cute.
I keep covering up your face.
I know what that yarn is now. Okay.
This yarn is actually... surprisingly one that I found at Joanne.
I like this one. I
and
like
I
this colorway.
And I am
it's
so glad it's...
Pigeons Croix.
Thank you. Oh yeah, of course it is.
I don't remember the name of...
Yes, it's Pigeons or Pigeons Croix. And I don't remember the name of the colorway, but I will try and go home and look for it. So I made the socks themselves, the bodies of the socks, match very well. But I did the heels, cuffs, and toes in... all these different colors. So this one has a blue cuff, a bright pink heel, and a green toe. And then this one has, and I loved the green, so I repeated it. It has the green cuff, the purple heel, and the orange toe. And I hope that she'll just really like them. And she was fun. She said that she has really narrow feet. So these are quite tight on these sock blockers.
How many stitches?
So I did 60, since I was doing them cuffed down, I went with her stitch recommendation for 64 stitches here, But then I decreased after the heel because her feet are very, very narrow, she says. Mm-hmm. And she says that normally when she knits toe-up socks, she does a 60 stitch. So I have 64 in the leg and then 60 in the feet. And so I hope that they fit her really well and that she likes the fun, crazy colors. And we're getting ready to swap.
Yay!
So that That's pink fun. Is showing like neon. It really isn't quite that bright. But anyway,
they're very cute. Is, so I like fun. It. And I like this yarn. I've been looking at it thinking I
wanted really to knit. I really like it. And it's another nice substantial one. Mm-hmm. I've knit with Croy before, but this was a new colorway that at least I hadn't seen it before. So it was fun to snatch that one
That's
up.
Fun. So for my partner, it's been really fun.
Really
because
has.
We get to know each other, what each other likes, just like, you know, some of those things, favorite colors.
Which is kind of the point. I mean, not just to knit mm-hmm. for each other, but to know each other.
Yeah, to kind of create friendships. And so I actually have two partners because I closed it a couple of hours early, and because of that, somebody that wanted to swap got in after I had closed it, and I felt really bad. And so I said, you know what? I'll knit two pairs of socks because, you know,
that's your goal for the year.
Yeah. So that was really fun. So the first person, Crystal, she's a Vintage Fairy LLC.
Oh, she's so fun.
She is on Instagram. She dyes yarn, and I thought I'm going to be brave and offer to dye yarn for her socks. And she said she was going to dye yarn for my socks.
So fun.
And she loves flowers, and roses are her favorite. And her favorite colors were yellow, purple, and pink. And so I thought I'm going to try dyeing a sock blank. Because that was on my list last year of things to do, but I didn't do it. And so I started with this one.
So cute.
Now, it ended up quite neon. I love it.
And I love how on the back it's a little bit less saturated, so
yes.
You're going to get even more variation. Does that make sense? Like, oh.
It's turned out really
fun.
I was so proud of myself because I've seen a lot of sock blanks and I thought that's got to be really, really hard. And I started painting and discovered I'm pretty good at it. I'm going to have to try that.
She's so good at everything she does.
No, I'm not. But,
yes, she is.
But I made that one and thought, and I had one other sock blank available and I thought I'll do one that's not quite as bright. It still ended up quite bright, but not as much. Here's what's left.
Fun. Oh, that's so fun.
And we discussed that we were going to show what the yarn that we dyed for each other. I let her choose. She wanted this one. And I love this. I love it so much. This one is going to end up in my Etsy shop.
It's so cute.
And I think I'll start doing some others. So I liked it because it was like painting with watercolors. I love that. So the socks I wanted to stick with the theme of flowers. So the pattern is wildflowers and honeycomb. And the socks are quite large for this sock blocker. And when you knit from a sock blank, it's kind of squiggly. And I didn't want to block it. I don't know if I'm going to because I kind of think there's a charm in it. And I want her to see it. And then she can maybe, if she wants, she can soak them. It'll happen once she washes them. But So the wildflowers and honeycomb pattern has a slightly different heel where the slip stitch heel texture is more on the outside of it, and it has a twisted rib, which I hadn't done that before. I don't know if I love doing it or if I love the twisted rib as much.
Oh, I love the look of it. I just don't like doing it.
But what I did on this one was if you can see the pattern, I didn't continue all the way down to the toe. I actually kind of created a V with, these are the wildflowers, the pattern here. I just created a V on that. But the sock blank is a double-stranded sock blank, and so these match
nice.
Really well how much, you know, color is in each section of the foot. So those are done and ready to ship off. And there's for my first partner.
That's so fun.
And then for my second partner, I've started her socks. And she loves red. It's Nancy. She loves red and earth tones. And red is a hard color to find, and to find many, I don't know, options. But there is a local dyer. I believe she was a local dyer for this one. Rhapsody Fiber Arts. They're at our local yarn shop, Knit and Pretty. Let's see if we can see that well. And the color is Darlene. And it is a, how would you describe this red?
Kind of a brick red.
Yeah, brick red with some grays. It makes me think of flannel, a men's flannel shirt.
Yeah, it's very handsome.
But she liked earth tones, and I thought, like, I'll too. Try and do that. But this sock, I wanted to keep it a little bit simple. And so I did Tin Can Knits rye sock. Really all it is just
garter stitch
down the center. That's really all it is. Mm-hmm. You know, I modified it a bit because the pattern calls for a heavier weight. I think it's worsted.
Yeah, they're made for like a big
bulky. Yeah, but she has a very narrow leg as well. And I really, my biggest concern is, are they going to fit?
That's what I always worry about.
I'm going to send some extra yarn, just in case of both, to make sure. And because of that, I did cuff down instead of toe up, so that if it's too short, they can add more to the toe.
Right.
So that was kind of my thought process there. But I've got just this much of this sock done. But Nancy was fast and sent mine already.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Do you want to see it?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, here we go. It came in the cutest package.
Oh, that cute little burlap. How fun.
That is. I've already opened it, so it's not as nice and tidy as when she sent it. But this is so much fun. So the socks she sent.
Oh, they're cute.
She had it all tied up pretty.
These are super cute.
These are really cute. So she did alternating toes and cuffs, or toes and heels as well.
Oh, yeah, she did. That's so fun.
And they fit perfectly. The colors are so fun. I love the self-patterning. These are really fun. And she did just a little...
texture.
Yeah, just a little, not cable, but line down both sides. Mm-hmm. And I really like these. She wanted a picture of me wearing them, so I'll have to get a picture on there. But they turned out so pretty. And she sent a little mini of the yarn that she used. And I don't know how to say this one, so I'm going to just show you. But this one is so cute.
That is really fun.
So, that was fun. She sent some tea and a postcard from, she's from Texas, and a little treat from Texas, which looks good because this one looks like it's gluten-free.
Nice.
Thank you.
That was good. And anything with caramel and nuts.
Oh, my favorite. My favorite. So this is really fun. I'm ready to ship one of my packages off. And I've got some little goodies to send. And now I've got this pair I can wear.
So cute.
And I've got this pair I can wear.
Yay.
So I now have 5-6 pairs of hand knit socks.
You're catching up with me. I gotta hurry up.
Okay, it's time to move on to snippets from the past.
I kind of feel like we need like sparkles.
I do. Like I put that on there.
Sparkles. There. You have to put it in like that.
Okay, I'm going.
Okay. We wanted to talk about crochet. So, and specifically lace crochet. So for a lot of years, I was a crocheter before I was ever into knitting or knew how to knit. And I liked to make blankets and things like that, but my favorite thing has always been to make lace. And so I had done quite a bit of it, but then just became so wonderfully enamored of knitting and obsessed of knitting, which really is my favorite thing. But the other, I think I just needed a palette cleanser. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Like I just, things have been really busy and kind of challenging, and I needed something that was really just lovely. So I started working on lace again, and I just recently, the other day, finished this.
This is so pretty, Emily.
I love it so much.
So what type of crochet is
this? This is filet crochet, which is crochet. It basically just uses chain stitches and double crochet, occasionally a single crochet in these little lace set sections.
Oh.
And it works on a grid. And so your chart pattern looks like very much like a color work chart would look, where it's just a grid and there's filled in sections, which are the ones that you work like this. Crochet. You fill those little blocks in with double crochet. And then there's the open sections like this, which are also made with double crochet, then chaining two, and then double crochet like that. And then I went and I just added this little border, which wasn't originally in it. Filet crochet can be very simple, or it can be very, very complex because of the edges and the way the shape changes. So if your finished project, like this one, is rectangular, it's quite simple to do your edges. You just start out with a row, and then you just build it row by row by row by row. But sometimes you'll have something that's, you know, scalloped or shaped like this, or even has like, sorry, that's more scalloped, or think diamond shaped, where you're increasing and decreasing at the beginnings or ends of your rows. And so you need to have a few more skills in that, but it's still quite simple. If you look at a finished project like this one, looks a little bit elaborate. It really isn't. It's all very, very basic.
I have one of Grandmother Gray's with houses across it.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I forgot.
So it's all just built out of very simple stitches, and you just look row by row and kind of color it in, if you will. Now, I started out working on a different project, which if you are a crocheter, you can look on my Ravelry projects page. Way down at the bottom, there's one called the Between Meals Centerpiece. It's a vintage pattern from 1912, and it's basically a lace doily, but it's about this big around. I mean, it's very large. And I had made that several years ago, I think in 2012, and had it on my table till about 9 or 10 months ago, when my very naughty youngest daughter was in a moment and took scissors to it, which was heartbreaking to me. So I had decided I was going to crochet that one again. I had finally gotten to the point where I wanted to make that again. But I had so many problems. I kept having to rip it out. It wouldn't lay flat. The center would not lay flat. And part of it was a tensioning issue because I just hadn't crocheted for a while. But when I got to almost to the edge and it was still not laying flat, I finally faced the fact that it wasn't going to block out, I went back and examined it, and there's actually a flaw in the written pattern, which apparently I had found the first time when I made this.
But didn't make any notes
about it. And so I ripped it out, and then I wasn't going to do that one. So that's why I made this. I have a rectangular dining room table, and I wanted something lovely to go on it, and I think that this one is just, it fits it perfectly.
It's very pretty.
I have some pictures of it on my table, so we will insert those.
I was going to show one. I completely forgot until this moment, because I didn't have it on my dresser anymore. I used to have it on my dresser, but my dresser was my grandmother's, and she had on there a filet crochet table runner kind of thing, and it was of houses. But this one is actually a gift that was given to me by one of the youth that I have worked with, that I mentor. And in my imaginary land called Christathel, we have a symbol that's a tree of life, a Celtic tree of life. And she took that and created this.
That's so lovely. Look at that.
She gave that to me this last year. I haven't decided how to properly display it. I've had it laying over kind of just the back of a chair in my living room, but I kind of want to mount it on something and hang it in my sewing room here, but I'm not sure.
Nice.
But how does this relate to our snippets from the past and from our ancestry and our creative history? We have a lot of family. I'm sure that just about everybody has family with some of these skills, because these are the skills that you had to have.
Right.
You know, you don't run out to the store and buy these things. Back then, you had to make it. And these were skills that you used to, that you worked on for years before you got married, and created some of these things for your home for when you got married. And so we learned these from our parents. I learned from my mother how to crochet.
Where did you learn? I learned from our aunt Alta, our great aunt Alta.
I have some of her crocheted lace mm-hmm. here. Now, this, there's a lot of staining in different areas.
But it makes it all the more lovely yes. because of that.
It's so pretty.
Let's hold it really nice and taut. So that
there we go.
Pattern. That's very pretty.
And I thought,
that's, I think, size 30 thread.
Right here, it'll say there. Hopefully. Maybe.
It's tatting and crochet thread. I can't see.
But
oh, it's in there.
Maybe you can, you're, she's much better at all
oh,
of these.
Oh, it's 100
things.
Count. Oh no, that's shade. Sorry. It's, this is an old label, so I'm trying to see if it says anywhere on there.
I wanted to figure out how, what this pattern was and try and make it, you know, finish this spool here and make more lace.
I can write it out for you if you want.
My mother, I learned to crochet. She can do just about anything. We learned a lot of skills, or at least I did for my mother. But she doesn't do them because she enjoys them. I think she does them mm-hmm. out of necessity. And so I only remember her crocheting once. I think she was making a shawl, mm-hmm. and I was watching her crochet, and I just was watching and noticed that she was doing some different stitches, different things, and asked her mm-hmm. how she did it, and went and grabbed some yarn. I was trying to watch her, and we only had one crochet hook in the house, mm-hmm. and so I went and got a wire coat hanger and cut it and bent it.
That sounds familiar.
I learned to crochet with a cut and bent coat hanger, but the cut edges were sharp, and the threads were, the yarn kept splitting, and it was so frustrating. That's how I learned to crochet, was with a coat hanger, and I used that for years.
I crocheted a lot with my fingers, just chain stitch. I would just chain stitch and chain stitch and chain stitch. But then, because I would go to Alta's, our great aunt, she's like our extra grandma. She never married. Yeah, she never married or had children, and so we would go sleep over her house and help her with chores. And I think back to the chores that we helped her with, and really she was just giving our mom an excuse that she needed us to come.
Though I did clean her oven and defrost her
freezer.
Oh,
that's true.
Every time I went.
Yes, she liked us to do that. But you know, it was more about spending time together, yep. and she would spoil us, she'd take us out to eat and take us to movies and buy us little presents and things like that. But she crocheted all the time. She made a lot of baby blankets, and she did some lace, obviously, as Deborah just showed. But she is the one who taught me to crochet, and she bought me my first crochet hook and my first yarn and taught me that. And but I always held my hook wrong. I always did it
yes.
wrong. Well, for years I thought, I do this wrong, but I kept doing it anyway. And then of course I realized, as we do as we grow up, that does it work? Then it's not wrong. Yep. Just go for it. It's
I was
just
so
a style.
Embarrassed by how I held it, because I just was watching and trying mm-hmm. to figure out how to do it. And I kept, you know, getting told that I was holding it wrong. So I was embarrassed to ever crochet in front of anybody, because what if I was doing it wrong and they were going to see me, and then they were going to, you know, and that's the same thing I discovered.
There isn't a wrong.
What does it matter?
It's just your process. Yes. It's your comfort. It's just like with knitting, how you, if you throw your yarn, flick your yarn, if you continental knit, use your left hand, your right hand.
How do you tension? Do you
yes.
tension? Do you just
I have one of my good friends, Jordan, who's a really very talented knitter. She does something that I think she calls it modified Russian, or she knits with some of her stitches that twist different, and mm-hmm. then she purls them differently and makes beautiful, beautiful things. It doesn't matter. It doesn't yeah. matter. We yeah. all have our own style.
There's not a right or wrong. It's just how do you do it.
Right. But I think that what happened is that these skills were taught from mother to daughter, and they had been taught that this is the right way to do it. And
yeah.
so they therefore really tried to do that. Plus, you know, we were a lot of, for years, for decades, these were skills that were taught in school.
Yeah.
So if you were a girl, only girls, of course, right? If you were a girl and you, when you were in school, you had your knitting class and you had your crochet class, you had your sewing classes. And while I adore those classes, there's also something to be said for finding your own way and
yep.
doing it in your own style.
So behind I have, these are little crochet dresses that were my husband's great-great-grandmother's. And we found them this last summer in his mother's Hoosier this vintage Hoosier she has kept in her house. And there was a jar in there that was always in there, and she had never opened it. I was going through, and these little dresses were in there. Aww. And she let me have them. I love these. And some of them are stained. Some of them, well, they're all a bit stained. Some of them are a little bit crispy. Some are softer, but I love finding those things from our family.
I do too.
I'm just thinking as we're talking of all of these things that were handmade from different family members that I've got stashed around.
And those really are my treasures. I'm not very sentimental about objects in general. I tend to be.
I'd rather dishes.
We all have our things, and I'm definitely that way about anything that my ancestors have made with their hands. So yeah.
We connect to that.
Right.
And when I do those things, I do feel a lot of the times that they are around me.
Yeah,
I feel like they're watching and that they're pleased that I'm continuing on with that. And that it's a connection. You know, I love to knit because I feel like it's very soothing and meditative, you know, with the repetitive motions and things, but it's not just that, but it connects us. It connects us to the earth. Like, I feel like when I'm knitting with wool and especially if I understand the process of it, and it connects me to my family, depending on what we're doing. And so I think that's what draws me to a lot of the domestic arts.
Absolutely. Well, one thing I wanted to say about crochet is that, especially about working with thread, is one of the wonderful things, and the reason I started doing this is because it is fairly inexpensive. It's about your labor instead of about the money. And so often with our gorgeous, luxurious, wonderful yarns that we use, the money can sometimes get in the way from you doing what you would really like to do. But working with, this is cotton crochet thread, and it will last. I mean, as we said, these are from her great-great-great-great-grandmother. I have some things from my great-grandmother, some that were linens that my grandmother had that had edgings that were crocheted, and they last because they're still natural fibers and they've been cared for. But you can create a thing of beauty without it being super expensive, because you can get those lovely but fairly economical crochet
and, you know,
threads.
With this is a luxury item. This is not a...
No, this is decorative, right?
That are useful because for a long time it was, you know, what is it that we need?
Right, but I mean, this, socks and scarves and hats and mittens.
Is this a need?
No.
But this is one of the things that makes a home.
Oh, I love it. It's so
pretty. Lovely and cozy.
It makes me want to drink a cup of tea.
It does. I'm going to call you Bouquet. Mrs. Bouquet.
Thank you. At least it's not Bucket.
All right.
I love it.
Oh, I do have a million acquisitions. I didn't want to go into all of those, but I do want to say that for my birthday, because it's been a while since we podcasted, so I didn't get to show this then, that my husband spoiled me rotten with an obscene amount of yarn.
So sweet.
So that bin that I showed you of yarn, he gave that to me because I told him I wanted that for something and he brought home a lot of it. He did, you know, a week of yarn birthday gifts. So every day he gave me a stack of yarn or a skein of yarn. And so that pile that I showed you and everything in here, I'm not going to go through all of these.
Ooh, that's pretty.
That one, actually, I'm going to knit him a hat with.
Ooh, that's very nice.
But a lot of beautiful yarns that he just spoiled me rotten.
Ooh, that's really pretty, too.
I know, there's so many pretty ones.
Ooh, this one's nice.
He's a very romantic.
What a sweetie.
And smart man, and I don't deserve him.
70% silk, 30% yak.
Yeah,
oh, my
feel
word.
That.
This yarn feels... Oh, it is so nice.
I wasn't going into all of these because it would take us all day. There are...
This one has to go by
two,
your face.
Three, four, five,
this one's
six,
not even... Like,
seven.
It won't even start scratching you.
No. I think there's nine of these. 50 grams.
Are they 50 grams?
Yes.
Are they lace?
No, it's not lace. It's a fingering weight.
Oh.
I don't know what to make. I don't know.
You have nine of them?
I think so. And then one, two, three of... these. Yeah. Anyways, I showed these on Instagram each day, what he gave me. And he obviously knows what colors, you know, I like bold,
yes,
vibrant,
beautiful,
solid, or tonals. Anyways, so he's very sweet. He's always been very good at giving gifts and finding just what I love. And so that was some of what he gave me.
You were supposed to look back, although you would find it in editing. She's like, hey, that's my yarn.
But at the same time, I joined Knitterly Things Rainbow of the Month Sock Club. Sock Yarn Color Club. I can't talk. And this was the first one.
So
everybody
fun.
That signed up for this should have already received theirs. And this one is a self-striping sock. And I actually saw that Amber on Yarn Hoarder, she'd already knit one sock. And so you could see what it looks
she
like.
She is a machine. That woman, how does she do it?
Well, she has her emergency knitting everywhere. Everything is emergency knitting.
She's amazing.
It's everywhere she goes. So I'm really excited to see these. I love rainbow. And this is on a glitter base. So it's gonna
glitter
be
is always good,
especially like, with rainbows.
I used to associate glitter with like the inexpensive baby yarns, like when people would just say that. I mean, this is a long time ago before I really saw the beautiful glitter yarns that are. But now I'm just like, oh, it's so cute.
Well,
so fun.
If it glitters and there's rhinestones attached, I'll go for
it.
If it sparkles, sequins, whatever, I don't care. Bedazzle the heck out of it. I need a bedazzled bag.
A bedazzled bag. I think that there should be a hashtag that is all that glitters is not yarn.
Is not yarn.
Okay. Because there's all that glitters isn't gold. All that glitters isn't yarn.
All right. At the very end, it's time for our what are you reading?
Okay. So I've been just having so much fun with the crocheting and the knitting and listening to audiobooks. So I've had a couple books I've been reading. I've been reading some really popcorn fantasy by Mercedes Lackey. That's been fun because they just like pick one up, take a deep breath, read the whole thing, then put it back down, right? But I've been listening to some audiobooks. So I recently re-listened to These Is My Words.
That is on my list of top 10 favorite books
it's
of all time.
So good.
I love Sarah
by Nancy
Agnes
Turner. Prime. Nancy E. Turner, I believe.
Yes.
And it is amazing. And I cried. And it's so well written.
There's actually three books. There's a series.
And I've only read the first one. So I'm definitely ready to read the second one. And, oh, I had mentioned before Persian Pickle Club. I had stopped reading that one, and then I finished it. And that's just such a fun one.
It is.
Just a fun.
And I like that one because that one's all about community, like
right.
The small town community.
And it's quirky. And
knitter, or actually, sewers.
Quilters, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
But now I'm reading Middlemarch by George Eliot, and I'm really enjoying it, and then alternately being extremely annoyed by it. So
I started it this last year. And I don't know, I couldn't get into it, so I want to get
It's very wordy. I mean, I kind of imagined that if Dickinson was writing Pride and Prejudice,
mm-hmm.
that maybe you would get a little bit of a feel, because you get that, I meant Dickens, I'm sorry.
That's what I heard.
I meant Dickens,
Dickens,
if I said, okay.
I know what you meant.
You've got the wordiness and kind of high language of Dickens, but you have the kind of quirks and foibles of the country gentry and their little annoyances and intrigues with each other. So I'm really enjoying the language of it. Juliet Stevenson is the narrator on Audible, and she is awesome. And if you have ever seen like Gwyneth Paltrow's version of Sense and Sensibility,
mm-hmm.
Juliet Stevenson is the woman who marries the vicar. Oh, anyway, and she's so obnoxious. So you would definitely recognize her. She does such a good job. But I'm also annoyed by it because I don't like any of the characters. They all are small-minded, annoying, selfish, conceited, or interfering kind of people. So I'm hoping that will change. But that's where I am.
I've been reading a lot of books, but the most recent finish, I'm trying to remember how many. Most recent finish would be A Last Babylon. And I actually listened to that
book
on Audible.
I haven't listened to it.
It was very well done.
I love
very
that
well
book.
Done. Now, I will say that the beginning of it, I didn't love some of the language, which ended I think. And that one was really just kind of the idea is what would happen if, you know, atom bombs were dropped on the U.S. right now, what would happen? Somebody had mentioned, that it was a conversation the author had had with a friend, and they said, oh, well, you know, thousands of people would die, but at least the U.S. would win. And he got to thinking about it. Well, would we? And what would happen? And it was very interesting, kind of like end of days kind of story. A lot of books you'll read, especially like dystopian books, it's a tragic event, some big event happened, you know, a while ago. And things have happened, and now here we are. This is the result of it. But Alas, Babylon really is leading up to the event, right during it, and, you know, 6 months after a major event, and kind of what would happen. And I was really impressed with the thought that went into it, because I wouldn't have really thought about all of the things that would really happen in a major catastrophic event like that. I now need to go and buy up salt.
I know. But we live in Utah. Salt. We have a salt.
I was thinking that. It's an endless supply of salt. We do have salt for the entire state. Plus some. So.
And interestingly enough, I mean, I'm sorry, I kind of interrupted you. I was going to say, Pat Frank is the author, and he wrote that during, I think it was 1959 when that book came out. And so it was in the biggest frenzy of the Cold War. When it was written, so that colors it all, and it's anyway, it's very.
But you can tell exactly. I mean, I could tell when it was written because of that.
Yeah.
But it was very, very well written. I would highly recommend that one.
And the thing about that one is, it's not just about an atomic bomb and what do you do. The whole point of it is the how do the people work together or not work together? What are the problem solving that they do, and that
and what happens to a community?
Exactly.
And what,
It's I love it. So.
So we read that, but at the same time, not reading, though I know it's inspired by books, my husband and I got wrapped up in a mini-series called Poldark.
Oh my gosh. Poldark.
We love hate it.
Yes, yes. It's like series of unfortunate events for adults.
Yes. Now, I will say that we watched the entire thing with remote in hand, ready to skip. Any inappropriate things, but many people may not find it inappropriate, but we just wanted to skip a lot of things. But I feel like...
Did you watch season two?
We are almost to the end of season two.
I haven't seen season two. I've only seen the first season.
You can watch it. But I am kind of irritated because I feel like so many writers write only for intense drama. Like, you can't have a good story unless there is always
something
100% tragedy.
Somebody dying.
And, like, our lives are very enjoyable and a good story, I feel like, when things good that are good are happening. And it can continue on for a long time.
Yeah, but the thing is, from a writer's perspective, if you don't have conflict, you don't have a story.
No, you need to have conflict. But I feel like
there's more kinds of conflict.
There's
too
much conflict than what is needful. It's almost just irritating, because I feel like, okay, two seasons worth span something like 5 years,
and nothing good has happened yet.
and what you've just gone from bad to worse to worse to worse to worse to worse. And in there might be a little blip of happiness. There you go. A little blip of... But my husband and I have fallen in love with the two main characters. That's... I'm Demelza. He's Ross.
Okay.
We love each other. He sends me little gifs or gifts of Poldark.
Oh, that's awesome.
So funny. We love it. Love it.
That's awesome.
So it's... I mean, love, but also hate. Come on, people. Happiness can happen in...
Happiness can happen.
Miniseries.
But not sell movie tickets.
Why do you think I read Pride and Prejudice? Come on. Happiness happens in the end. But
yes, but we have to actually talk about that just briefly since we're talking about reading. Jane and I are going to have a talk in heaven someday. I'm going to say, Jane, would it have killed you to show us them actually having the happy moment? Instead
That's
of
true.
Saying, and in a short, in just a few short minutes, everything was resolved between them.
Yes. Yep.
Mean Jane.
Because
just
she
mean.
Was very good at the description of everything else.
Yes, but then when
it
got to
tired,
the payday,
it was
just
like nothing.
Yeah, here you go. So anyway, just had to say that. Thanks a lot, Jane.
Yeah.
We're buddies, Jane and I.
All right. Oh, at the very end, shop update.
Yeah, this is exciting.
I've been sewing a lot of bags. Well, I've always sewn bags, but here's one that I just made.
That... Look at that cute trim. Is that actually...
No.
Oh, it's just, is it twill tape?
It's twill tape along the bottom of trim.
Cute, in the ruler.
I love drawstring bags. I go through phases of making a whole bunch of zippered bags and then drawstring. But drawstring, I think, are my favorite. And this one's a smaller one.
Look at those cute sheep.
I know the sheep are adorable.
They're so puffy.
In the last episode I showed, I had made a little house, little zippered bag, and that was for the Notions pouch swap for my partner, and I had made a couple of extra because they were fun to make, and I put them in my shop and they sold, so I made a couple more and then they sold and I made a couple, so I just made a stack because they're going like crazy and I just added them in my shop, so I have a whole bunch in there that are really fun and they're just perfect size for little Notions pouches.
So cute.
So these have been just kind of fun things for me to make when I have some time.
I'm buying that one.
You're buying that one? Which one? Which
this one? One.
I thought you'd like this one.
Oh. Hold on. Now I have to decide. But this one has roosters, and this one has daisies.
And this one, too, looks like you. But those two look
But so does this one right here.
So these have been fun. I'm sending some of these out to a
so
few
one
friends.
Of these will be unavailable. I have to decide. I actually think I have this one in my cart right now, but I don't want to pay shipping.
Well, just call me, Emily. I bet we could work something out. I bet we could even work out some minis, a swap. I want to swap with some people. For minis
point.
For my the blanket that I want to make, my friendship blanket.
So you want to swap minis? Like you send them minis, they send you minis?
Cause no,
you
want to
send them
send
a bag.
Bag.
Oh my word!
Minis.
You could get one.
Because this is what I'm looking for, though,
so
people.
Cute.
Okay, I want. Grab your blanket. There we go.
We'll show you examples. I'm gonna show examples of what I think you want.
Okay, you show.
Okay. So let's see. This, not so. No, okay.
Yeah,
okay. This one,
yep.
Yes. 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 This one, no. This one, no. This one, see no stripes. Speckles, tonals, and nicely saturated, beautiful, bold colors.
Very good. You are so smart. You are so smart. SMRT. So if you want to do a swap with me, you can get in touch with me through Instagram.
That's pretty awesome.
I can't do that with everybody, but we can do that with a few people, and I'll swap some bags for.
Decide.
I'll have to determine what I need exactly, but I'll do a swap with you, Emily, for some minis, okay? So yes. All right, we have to go.
Okay.
Because it's been a long time.
Thank you so much for joining us and sticking with us. And we are really just so excited to know all of you. So have a great, great week or two. Hopefully it won't be too long before we're back again.
Can't make any promises, but we love you, so we will be
yes.
back.
Thank you. So. Bye.